Okay, everyone, we're going to get started. And I want to welcome everyone to our virtual grand rounds today with Sheila Baker, who's on the screen here right now. And I'd also like to welcome, I think we have our first cohort of applicants for our residency here, and many of them will be online this morning. So this is our typical and somewhat atypical as well grand rounds. We meet at 8 o'clock on Wednesdays, usually in person, but today we're having a guest lecturer from University of Iowa, and it's Sheila Baker. And Sheila, just to give a little bit of background, because I don't think Sheila and I have ever met in person, as far as I know. So she's from the Midwest, or at least trained, did her undergraduate degree at University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point, and then got her PhD at the Medical College of Wisconsin. She did a postdoctoral fellowship from 2003 to 2005 at Mass Eye and Ear, and then was a research associate at Duke University. Since then, she's been in Iowa at where she became an assistant professor in 2010 and was promoted to associate professor. And she is in biochemistry, so it's biochemistry of eye disease. And she'll be talking today about KCNV2 retinopathy, a story of mice and men. And for those of the residents here, we're doing our retina bowl tomorrow. So this could have been a question on there, because this, what's important about KCNV2. And she'll talk about that and what's interesting in terms of electrophysiology today. And since she's a biochemist, she focuses obviously on mice and other animals. But when I saw the title of her talk and said, as a clinician, I do know something about that. And even though it's a rare disease, I think it's on the order of a 1 in a million disease, we have a database here of our patients. And I do see patients with this. And all I had to do was write a quick email to Emily Spoth, our genetic counselor. And she came back within 10 minutes and said, these are the three patients that we have with this disease. So this is translational. This is gonna be a translational talk. And to start things out, I'm going to have Lydia Sauer give just a very brief presentation of our and some pictures of our three patients before we go to Sheila.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to share the screen here. All right, can everybody see this? So I'm going to talk about just the clinical cases of KCNV2 retinopathy that we have seen at the Moran Eye Center. And as Dr. Bernstein mentioned, there are three cases that we have seen. All three of those have been genetically analyzed. The first one is a 23-year-old male with a compound heterozygous KCNV2 mutation with two pathologic alleles. The second one is a 37-year-old female that is heterozygous in a VUS. And the third one is a 16-year-old female with a compound heterozygous that is likely pathologic. And the person with the VUS has a very similar phenotype, and we think that she actually has the disease. And here are the three fundus photographs, as well as fundus autofluorescence intensity images. And I just want to highlight the clinical features and the general things about this mutation. So it's an autosomal recessive rod cone disease that is not RP. The onset is in the first to second decade of life, and it has a prevalence of 1 in 865,000 people with an incidence of 5 new cases per year. So it's pretty rare. And KCNV2 encodes for a voltage-gated potassium channel that sets the photoreceptor resting potential and is responsible for the voltage response. Symptoms that the patients will experience are central scotomas, poor visual acuity, variable photophobia, and red queen dyschromatopsia with a relative blue sparing. And then the findings that we see on imaging would be a ring-like or bullseye change in the macula, central atrophy, increased foveal autofluorescence, and variable OCT findings with like variable outer retinal integrity, loss of the ellipsoid zone, and central hyporeflective spots. And all three patients showed this in both of their eyes. And the very important pathognomonic finding is the electroretinogram signature, where in the dark adapted state, the A wave is normal to near normal with a late negative component, But the B wave has a relatively high amplitude and it's called, or it can be supernormal. And these are just two of our patients who had ERG imaging. And that's a very classic finding that's very specific to KCNV2 mutations. And I think that Sheila is going to talk more about that. And with that, I'm actually going to have Nana come up because he has some fun facts about her. And then we will give the word to Sheila. Thank you.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. So we couldn't let her start without a couple of fun facts. So she has two cats who you might be able to get a glimpse of during her presentation, named Dungy and Monkey Girl. And then she has, she's an avid reader, a big fan of the Murderbot Diaries. So with pleasure, we'll pass it over to Dr. Baker. And so you can begin your presentation here.
All right. Thank you very much. That was lovely. Let's see, let me just share my, get my screen set up here. Okay, hopefully now we should be good. You should be seeing my title slide and able to hear me. Is that all good?
Yeah.
Great, thank you. So first of all, I want to thank you for accommodating my request to have this meeting virtually. There are a number of personal reasons why travel is difficult for me. And one upside for me out of the whole chaos that is the pandemic is that we learned how to do virtual meetings better. So I really appreciate you allowing me to do this. So yes, today I'm going to tell you about work we've been doing in my lab recently, investigating the biochemistry and molecular biology underlying KCNV2 retinopathy. And I didn't know we'd have such a lovely presentation. So I have my real quick intro to the disease. So we commonly call it in the field KCNV2 retinopathy, and that name is very sensible. It's a disease of the retina caused by mutations in the gene KCNV2. And I'll be telling you all about how that affects the protein, whose name is KD8.2. Now, more formally, at least according to OMIM, the disease should be called retinal cone dystrophy 3B, but the only other name I have ever come across is cone dystrophy with supernormal rod responses. This name is very cumbersome, but I like it because it helps me understand what's going on. And I also like it because it gives me a short acronym I can put on all my title slides. So I will be going back and forth using CDSRR or KCNV2 retinopathy interchangeably. As we just saw, the key features of this disease is that it starts early in the first and second decade of life. It's characterized by a macular degeneration that typically can start as early as the second decade of life, and it's progressive. Sometimes it starts later. And when you have a macular degeneration, you tend to get a lot of phenotypes consistent with cone dystrophy, such as loss of visual acuity, loss of color vision, and photophobia. So this part helps with the name of the disease. The first part is cone dystrophy. But there are a number of genetic explanations for why a person might have a cone dystrophy. What sets this particular disease apart is that it also has variable amounts of night blindness in patients. And most strikingly, it's characterized by the abnormal ERG. And that's where the part of the disease named supernormal rod responses come from. This is truly unique. And this, and because the ERG is a recording of the electrical activity of the retina, this really gives me some insight into what's going wrong. And then I have one fundus image from a patient seen at Iowa. So as we just learned, this disease is incredibly rare, but there doesn't seem to be any particular genetic or ethnic group where the disease shows up. It just happens all around the world. You'll find cases everywhere. We have them at Iowa. Obviously, I feel bad for the patients, but I'm quite glad to hear that you've seen them and you can help me understand this disease from your perspective. I will also make a point that I think that there's a high likelihood that this disease is underdiagnosed. And to help explain that, I want to tell you my own experience sort of with a patient. So I'm a basic fundamental scientist. I'm a lab rat myself, and I don't interact in the clinics. But when I first got this grant to study KCNV2 retinopathy, I had someone contact me. It was really, really quite nice. They just started by thanking me for actually studying their incredibly rare disease. But through a series of communications, this particular patient volunteered their medical history in an effort to help me better understand what was going on. And this had a huge impact on me and well as my lab, very motivating. So I want to encourage you that when you do see maybe rare patients that perhaps the PhDs in your eye center are studying, go ahead and invite them into the clinic and let them see exactly how the disease is affecting the life of their patients. It can be really rewarding. So in this particular patient, their history starts as young as 5 years old. They went into clinic, they were treated for amblyopia. They also reported at that time that he was already struggling with tracking small objects, had poor color vision, especially under low contrast conditions. Then in his early teens, he was really struggling with reading in dim light. And he went in for testing. He was given a visual field test, but he failed it. But there was no diagnosis given at that time. He was just told, yeah, you just did a bad test. And they let him go on with his life. So a few years later, he went back for more testing because he was starting to notice progressively failing central vision, which he described as there's a dark blob over people's faces, which is exactly how my grandmother with AMD describes her vision. Adaptation for this patient is delayed, and he described that as anytime he moves from a bright room to a dark room, or conversely, a dark room into a bright room, has to pause, and it takes quite a bit of time for him to adjust. His visual acuity was not too bad at that point. And then just a few years later, he was diagnosed with something similar to Stargardt's disease. And the main complaints that he had is he continued to have difficulty tracking objects. When he was a young child, it was tracking small objects that were hard for him. And now it's becoming harder and harder, even the large objects, including cars. So I was very glad to hear that he had stopped driving. Although his excuse for stopping to driving is that he was having a hard time seeing stoplights, road signs, and potholes. I think you should be more concerned about the other cars more than the potholes, but there you go. His vision under dim light, meaning rod mediated vision, was becoming worse, and his visual acuity was dropping off a little bit more. Finally, when he was 25 years old, he underwent genetic testing and finally had an ERG done. And that ERG and the genetic testing is what allowed him to move from you have something wrong with your retina that kind of looks like this other disease to an accurate diagnosis of cone dystrophy with supernormal rod responses, CDSRR, or KCNV2 retinopathy. At this point, we really can't do very much for the patient. He's working with various low vision devices. He uses a lot of contrast inversion, works under very bright light, and can still work on the computer, having to use Zoom in large fonts. So I'm in a position where I'm a photoreceptorologist, and I think that I know enough about photoreceptors that I was really intrigued by this disease, and I thought I might have some ideas and be able to explain what was going on. And if I could do that, I thought that I could work with people such as yourselves, and we might be able to come up with better options for patients like this person, as well as your own patients and any others in the future. For those of you who are particularly interested, this patient did, when he had his genetic testing done, it was found that he was heterozygous for two variants in KCNV2. One is pathogenic, and I have a good explanation, I believe, for why that is. But if you're really interested in the molecular details, you'll have to stick around for my research seminar later on today. And then there's a mutation where we really don't know what's going on, which is unfortunate for the patient, but good for me because it means there's more work I have to do. All right, so now what exactly is KCNV2? It is a relatively small gene. I'm sorry, I think I'm sharing this window. There we go. Make that a little bit easier. So it's a relatively small gene, simple two exons. Its coding sequence is a little bit less than 2 kilobases. That's good. Anyone who's thinking about gene therapy, like, aha, that can fit into AAV viruses if this seems like a good idea. And again, it's very rare, but in the last 15 years or so, I've combed through everything in PubMed and have found at least 61 variants that I think it's reasonable to say that they are definitely linked to causing the disease. When you look at the types of variants that show up in the gene, about 50% of them are nonsense mutations or frame-shifting mutations that are going to result in the absence of protein expression. And I think that's interesting. This is a case where such patients would be the best candidates if anyone were to develop a gene therapy for this disease. The other 50% of the mutations are missense mutations. And I've drawn onto this cartoon showing the topology of the protein, KV8.2. So this is a membrane protein. It has 6 membrane spanning domains. Its organization is that of a typical voltage-gated ion channel. So it has a domain that functions or can function in sensing voltage. And then it has a domain that will form a pore. It has a third domain that's a little bit unique to this particular family of ion channels. It has what's called the T1 domain, and that's used to interact with other ion channels that are related to it. And I'll be telling you a lot more about that in a second. The missense mutations that have been reported for the gene will affect the entire length of the protein. They're scattered throughout the different domains, but the bulk of them that we know about to date impact the T1 domain. So what is that T1 domain? How does it affect the protein? And then how does the protein affect our vision, right? This T1 domain is going to be important for assembly. So I have to tell you about now, you have to learn about more than just one ion channel today. You have to learn a little bit about the larger family of voltage-gated potassium channels. So this is a family that's subdivided into different groups. You have KV1, 2, 3, and 4. These all form ion channels that are expressed throughout the nervous system, the heart, the pancreas, and in several other places at lower levels. Probably most familiar with these channels because they are responsible for generating and propagating action potentials in the nervous system. Consequently, patients with mutations in the genes encoding these channels typically present with epilepsy. Now, one thing that I find interesting is that you can sort of fine-tune neuronal signaling by adjusting the exact type of ion channels that a neuron will express. And diversity in signaling within this family is achieved by mixing and matching different subunits. What that does is it affects the biophysical properties of the channel, so you get slightly different transmission effects. This family is divided, so this is a family where no kissing cousins are allowed. So for instance, the genes within the KV1 subfamily can mix and match and assemble with each other, but they don't interact with KV4, KV3 is alone, KV2 is the interesting exception. KV2 is closely related to a large subfamily that is called the KVS for silent. And I will explain that in just a moment. First, I want to tell you that in the retina, even though we have all of these different KV genes in the genome, in retina, we only have 2 to worry about. One from this KVS family, our 8.2, the culprit for the topic today, as well as KV2.1. And we think that they'd form an ion channel that would look something like this, with the transmembrane domains forming a voltage sensor here, pore in the center, and then that T1 domain hanging down like a gondola in the cytoplasm. These ion channels are expressed in photoreceptor inner segments. And just a word of warning here. We all know that culturally, we like to put things that are most important to us at the top when we present slides. And as a photoreceptorologist, all of my retina pictures have photoreceptors at the top. So you might need to take just a brief second and flip that image in your head to have it make sense. But this is the outer nuclear layer, photoreceptor layer, outer plexiform layer, inner nuclear layer, ganglion cells are cut off. So what you see here is labeling for KV8.2 and 2.1, and they're found in the inner segments of photoreceptors. Now, what's the deal with having both of these? Well, they're having interdependence. And first, let me tell you a bit more about KV8.2 and why it's called the silent channel. The easiest way to explain that is to show you this nice experiment from a paper in 2012. These are heterologous cells that have been transfected with protein. What you see, if you express KV8.2 all by itself, it forms this beautiful reticular pattern, but there's none of it out at the plasma membrane. So if an electrophysiologist puts a patch pipette on that cell, they will record no current. Hence, it's an electrically silent channel. We don't actually know that, there's just no channel actually at the surface. However, when you co-express 8.2 with 2.1, now you do get it released from internal stores and it traffics out to the surface and you record a current. But having 8.2 assembled with 2.1 does affect 2.1 as well. Not its trafficking, but its activity. So what happens? This is, again, a figure from the literature. This is a paper in 2007. And this is a little bit complicated, but I'm going to just take you through the key observation here, at least in my mind. So the upper plot is the normalized current plotted as a function of membrane voltage. What I want you to pay attention to is this range down here. So photoreceptors in the dark adapted condition have a resting membrane potential of about minus 35. And then when they hyperpolarize in response to light, they go more negative, minus 70. So there's a little bit too much information in this graph, but if you'll pay attention to the lines with the square symbols, this is the activation data for this channel. And the white squares alone are just KV2.1. And this channel forms a beautiful, well-functioning homotetrameric channel throughout the nervous system. But its activation kinetics are such that in a photoreceptor, it would be closed at all times. However, when you add in 8.2, now the activation curve shifts to the left so that at photoreceptor operating potentials, you do have open channels. Now, there's not a whole lot, but that's exactly what you want, because if you only have a small population of channels that have a high open probability, that means small changes in the number of channels that are open or closed are going to have a big effect on the output of the cell. So adding 8.2 changes the membrane potential at which the channels will open. The other thing that happens is it affects when they will close. So in the lower plot, you're looking again at normalized current as a function of time this time. When 8.2 channels are open, they will inactivate with a set kinetics. But when you add in 8.2, that is slowed by nearly 50%. And the reason I've taken you through this in this detail is not because I'm an electrophysiologist and I'm therefore inherently fascinated by this, even though it is really cool. But these two features, a channel that opens at more negative potential and has a very slow inactivation, is characteristic of, at the time this was published, a channel for which we did not know the molecular carrier. A channel in photoreceptors carrying a current known as IKX. So just a potassium current with the designation of X because the molecular identity of the channel was not known. So the work that I'm describing here led to the proposal that the molecular carrier of this particular current was this heteromeric channel. And what I hope I convince you of today is that when we look at mouse models where we disrupt this channel, and this has worked on my lab as well as two other labs in the last 3 years, hopefully you'll be convinced that this is indeed true and we know this now. So the significance of that is more impactful if we go back, take a step back and think about how photoreceptors signal. So I'm glad that there are some younger students in the audience, so hopefully this won't be too much review for everyone. But if you think about a cartoon here of a rod photoreceptor, and we're zooming in now at the inner outer segment. As we know, we have outer segment is responsible for light detection, right? This is our rhodopsin, this is a phototransduction cascade that biochemists love to ask you detailed questions about just to see if you were paying attention. But the upshot is if you think about photoreceptor signaling in terms of the currents experienced by the cell, it's easiest to describe the dark adapted photoreceptor as having a circulating dark current. There's positive ions flowing into the outer segment in the dark, and this is balanced by positive ions flowing out of the cell from channels in the inner segment. The bulk of that positive efflux comes from IKX or Kv2.1 A.2. Also need to point out that because the sodium potassium ATPase exchanges an unequal number of sodium for potassium ions, there's actually a net efflux of positive charge from this transporter. So it also contributes in a smaller way to this net circulating current. This is what keeps the photoreceptor depolarized in the dark. Went too fast, that's okay. When the lights flash on, what's gonna happen is activation of the phototransduction cascade is gonna effectively close the channels in the outer segment, breaking that circulating current. There's no immediate response to what's happening in the inner segment, so the membrane potential moves more negative. Now the channel does deactivate, it just does so a little bit slower. And while it's open and there's an opportunity for this channel to sort of help shape and filter the ultimate response of the cells. As the light continues or gets brighter, the cell will be driven into more and more negative potentials until there's other channels that will help reset the cell until you reset the phototransduction cascade. And I mostly mention this current right here is on this slide because in the last few years, 10 years, we've actually done a lot of work on HDN1. So if you have questions about that and you want to talk about it in your one-on-one, we can do that. But coming back to KCNV2 disease, understanding that this channel is helping to control the resting membrane potential in the dark, and the fact that it doesn't immediately switch off when the lights are turned on, allows it to filter responses, lets us make some predictions about what would happen if you have a non-functional channel, which is what we think is the case in our disease of interest. It should reduce or delay the photoresponse. So in order to test this, I am not someone who's gonna poke around with human beings. Instead, I'm gonna do this in mice. But I want to address a big elephant in the room, first of all. This disease is characterized by macular degeneration, and mice don't have a macula. So some of you might be thinking, why are you wasting my time with this? Well, I don't think I'm wasting your time. I think we can learn a lot from mice, even though they don't have a macula. And my specific argument is this. In the mice, we know that they have a very beautiful array of rods. It's actually quite similar to the human distribution in structure and function distribution. So whatever's going wrong in KCNV2 retinopathy with the rods would hopefully be phenocopied. In terms of the cones, we have roughly the same number of cones to rod ratio in mice as in humans. We're just missing the macula and that high density for central vision. But that means that if what's going wrong in the disease is intrinsic to cone physiology, or is either driven by coupling to dysfunctional rods, we should still be able to recapitulate the basic mechanism in mice. On the other hand, if all of your assumptions that it's silly to study a macular disease in mice is correct, that actually by testing that in mice, I can confirm that. We can say if we don't see a phenocopy of the disease, it tells us that there is indeed something unique about the structure or function of the macula that's contributing to the disease, and that will help us focus in on future efforts to understand the disease and treat it. So I hope I've made my case. With that, we made a knockout mouse. This was at a time when our mouse genome editing facility was fairly new, so it was very fun to play with designing the CRISPR guides and making our mouse, but we set this up to cause a frame-shifting deletion that would result in truncation of the protein very, very early on. We should get no protein. We do Western blots, and indeed, KV8.2 is gone. We looked at a few related channels, and there were some minor changes. We don't really know what those mean yet. So next, I'll draw your attention over here. This is our immunohistochemistry. Again, photoreceptor side up. In the wild type, we have labeling in the inner segment, and in the knockout, the labeling is gone. You'll also notice that in the knockout, the outer nuclear layer is thinner, so we have retinal degeneration. And I'll be talking about that, but first I want to address the ERG phenotype because that's the diagnostic characteristic of this disease. And if this mouse model is going to be useful at all, it has to phenocopy that aspect. So here we go. You saw some ERGs really quickly, thanks to Lydia. I really appreciate that. These are some on the left-hand side. You have sample ERGs, again, taken from the literature. So here you have a stimulus condition that will evoke a rod-dominated response. You have hyperpolarization of the photoreceptors reflected in the downward A wave. And then you have the upward reflection or the B wave that comes from the response of the depolarizing or on bipolar cells in the inner retina. And what you see here is that the A wave response is fairly similar, although that varies across patients. But what's unique and definitive is that the B wave is larger. This is the supernormal rod response, part of the name of the disease. If you use a stimulus condition that evokes more cone-dominated responses, again, normal patients give you a robust B wave. Here's the A wave, here's the beautiful B wave, but the B wave is now reduced when it's elicited by cone signaling. And if you use a flickering light stimulus to isolate cones, you see that, again, the cone response is reduced. What we have on the left-hand side are ERGs from the mouse. And the simple description is they're the same as humans. Where you see differences, they're mostly just mouse-human. So, for instance, on the rising B wave of the mouse ERG, you see a lot more of these oscillatory potentials. That's a mouse-human difference. But what we have is we have the supernormal B wave response for the rods, and we have reduced signaling coming from cones. Now, what you can do with the mice that's difficult to do with the patient is you can put them through more extensive ERG testing and try to learn more. So we did quite a lot of that. I'm going to show you just two sets of experiments. The first is asking more detail about the rod response. So here what we're doing is we're using dark adapted mice. We give them a flash of light that elicits a response, and then we repeat that with increasing intensity of light. So you get what's called this flash family. And the really amazing thing here is when you compare the wild type traces, which are in black, to the knockout traces, which are in red, you see that the effect is different depending on the lighting. So here early on in response to very low light, you'll see that the red traces are delayed for when you see the B wave, and then that B wave is small at the very most dim light. Just a slight increase in light, though, will start moving us into that supernormal B wave response. And what you can also see here is I'm going to focus in on the A wave, because the A wave is reflecting hyperpolarization, is that closure of channels and outer segments where KV 2.1, 8.2 is really contributing to regulation. And so the A wave, it's easiest to see what's happening here in these lighting conditions under very dim light. The A wave is very slow. It's delayed to respond. You do get a full amplitude response. It just takes a long time to get there. However, when you go to brighter light, it speeds up and you now start seeing the onset of this wave matching for wild type and knockout. But if you're going to go fast, you can't get as big of a response. So the A wave plateaus out. So here's the summary. Under dim, very dim response lighting conditions, the A wave is delayed. Under brighter flash, and keep in mind this is bright for a rod, the amplitude is reduced. Okay, how does that make sense? Let me give that a try. So we come back to my cartoon of signaling that's happening. I'm skipping the dark adapted condition. We're just looking at the light. In the light, the channel in the outer segment is closed. And the IKX channel should be there and slowly inactivating. But in this disease where you don't have 8.2, you're left with just 2.1. And remember, that means its voltage of activation is shifted, so it should not be open. Effectively, you have zero channel here for IKX. So the only thing supporting the light response here in this knockout would be the activity of sodium potassium ATPase. And forgive me for being maybe a little bit too simple, but one way I like to describe this is you're really messing up the amount of potassium you have in the extracellular space around the photoreceptor. You really don't have enough go juice to get the response you need. I don't know why under some conditions the photoreceptor sacrifices speed for amplitude and vice versa, but the effect is the same. If you don't have enough positive charge in the extracellular space, one of those two things is going to happen, and we happen to see both of them. Okay, I'm going to throw in here just a quick note now about the B wave, mostly because that's just a characteristic of the name, right? It's the supernormal rod response, which is actually a little bit deceptive because under the most dim lighting conditions for rods, the B wave is actually underperforming, and it's only after this you make this switch between sacrificing time versus amplitude that you start to see that supernormal response. So this is a little bit hard to think about, but the way that it makes sense to me is I want to come back to one of these traces over here. Because the onset of the B wave is always delayed, even though this A wave is not reaching its full amplitude, you do have an A wave response, and it's sort of squared off. It keeps going. And that means you can't really drive the cell all the way to its full hyperpolarized condition. You don't have the other mechanisms to help return the cell to its resting state in its normal timing. So in some ways, even though you don't have a large amplitude, you have more continuous drive for the signal. And I think that's why you get the larger B wave. Not because there's an effect specifically in the bipolar cells, but just because the information coming from rods is not stopping. So you get an accumulated large or supernormal B wave response. Okay. One more set of ERGs I want to show you. Here we're using a different stimulus, a sinusoidal flicker stimulus. So the first set of experiments were designed to be more similar to what you might see in the clinic. But this one is a little bit more helpful for me. Using a sinusoidal flicker, we're just taking a step closer to a more normal lighting experience. And we can analyze the waveforms you get from this. And one of the things that we learn is that across various frequencies, the response is always reduced in the knockout mice. And because this is a flickering stimulus, we know this is in large part driven by cones. So this is absolutely reproducible. We see that across the board. When we use this particular ERG protocol under very low frequencies, we can actually isolate information from the rods. And here, this is what the raw waveforms look like. Below, this is their light stimulus. So in the white, when the lights go on, we elicit the positive B wave. Again, black is our wild type and red is our knockout. And then because the signal continuously flickers, we actually we are able to see another component of the ERG that we didn't see in our first set of experiments, and that is a second positive going wave that is called the C wave. Now, this is important in this disease because the C wave is generated by the Müller cells, and they do this in response to the light-induced drop in extracellular potassium. So without KB2.1, KB8.2, that extracellular potassium amount should be lower. Therefore, the change between light and dark should be smaller. And indeed, the C wave is smaller. So we can see that, and this then conforms to our hypothesis. All right, we did more ERG, but I'm going to spare you. We're going to now move on to the degeneration. Now, here in mice, we used OCT. Again, retina is upside down to the way most of you guys look at it. But here in the yellow bars, this is the outer nuclear layer, photoreceptor layer. So we just measured that over time in wild type and knockout. You can focus in here on panel C. What we see is that at 2 months of age, we have some thinning in the retina, not too big of a deal, about 10% thinner at this point, but that progresses fairly slowly so that by about 10 months of age, we've lost about 30%. Now, this is a little bit different because the majority of patients that I've read about for KCNV2 retinopathy don't have any obvious thinning of the peripheral retina. So this might be a mouse specific thing here. The other piece of information I have on this slide is labeling for GFAP. This is a marker for reactive gliosis. And indeed you can see that that is upregulated in the retina, and you can see that the Müller cells are starting to express the GFAP and starting to fill some of the processes in the inner retina. Now, this is very commonly seen anytime you have a photoreceptor degeneration, but this is happening very early on in this particular disease. At 2 to 3 months, when we're just starting to see photoreceptor drop out, we're seeing the Müller cells respond, which might be sensible because they're electrically part of the problem, as we saw with the C wave in the ERGs. Now, here's a really important question. What about the cones? Cones are only 3% of the photoreceptors. So if we're losing 30% of the retina, we know a lot of this is coming from the rods. What's happening to the cones? To answer that, we did retinal flap mounts and we labeled for code arrested. Now, this is obviously a very low magnification picture. You can't see individual cells, but what we did is we collected regions of interest at different eccentricities. And that's because even though the mouse retina does not have a macula, there's a very slight increase in density of cones as you go more towards the center. So we looked at these different eccentricities comparing the cone density. And what we saw is absolutely no difference between wild type and knockout. We first did this experiment with 6 months old mice. And then my colleague slash competitor from Australia, who had a different line of KB8.2 mice, published her own analysis. And they did see a slight loss of cone density. So we repeated this experiment in our mice, but this time aging them out to 1 year of age. And this is the data from the 1 year old mice. No difference, no loss of cones. All right, at this point though, I wanted to push a little bit harder on what would be happening with cones. And we have in the lab a strain of mice, which you may or may not have heard of before. So if you've heard of the NRL mouse, take a moment to daydream. I'm just gonna explain this to those of you who haven't. NRL is a transcription factor expressed in the retina as required for specification of cones. So if you have a knockout mouse, all of the photoreceptors are cone-like photoreceptors instead of being rods. The NRL mouse is used throughout our field to study cone-dominant biology in the retina, but it's a difficult retina to work with because, as you can see from this picture, it's morphologically abnormal. The cone nuclei, instead of being a nice smooth layer, form all these infoldings and rosettes. So instead, I got a variation of the NRL knockout from Christian Grimm, where he crossed it with another line of mice and obtained a normal, beautiful morphology, where the outer segment, or where the outer nuclear layer happens to be just all cones. So to make sure I'm very clear that this is not the pure NRL knockout line, we call this the coneful mouse. Here's our own histology. The retina looks pretty good. The outer nuclear layer is not as well organized. It's not as compact, but that's because it's cones, not rods. And the outer segments are obviously much shorter. This is not a degenerated retina. It's just missing long rod outer segments. So we took this mouse, we crossed it to our KV8.2 knockouts. And what did we get? Well, when we did ERGs now, targeting the cones, you can see, again, black is wild type, red is knockout, the response is reduced exactly by 50%. Great. So one of my questions, which you may remember early on, was, is it possible that the defect in cone-driven signaling, that reduction in the B wave, is actually driven by the dysfunctional rods? And the answer from this experiment is no, it's intrinsic to cone signaling. B and C are just quantitations of the A wave. The A wave in this protocol is very, very small. There's a lot of variability. We don't see anything that's statistically significant, but we do see this reliable reduction in the B wave. This experiment was done at 1 month of age on the mice because we know that in the NRL knockout and the coneful mice, there is a degeneration that occurs. So this experiment was done at 1 month of age to check and make sure everything was okay. We did histology at 2 months and then we followed it up with it 4 months. So at 2 months, the coneful mice with a normal copy of KV8.2 looked just fine, as well as the animals that are missing 8.2. But when we looked at 4 months, here the outer nuclear layer is a little bit more disorganized in this particular image, but it's actually within statistical normal range. However, by 4 months, the animals missing 8.2 have a striking degeneration. So in this particular environment, cones do degenerate in the absence of KV8.2. This brings me to my summary of the mouse work, and this is work that we've all published. So I'm going to do a quick summary and then move on to unpublished data so you can learn what I'm thinking about for the future. So briefly, we have a mouse model where the ERG phenotype is common to mice and humans. Those features I've described in the name of the disease, and it supports the hypothesis that the problem is insufficient extracellular potassium, can't support the dark current required for resting membrane potential, and it can't filter responses in response that come from light. In the mice, we see clear degeneration of rods. I don't really understand if this is consistent with the human disease as it's described in the literature right now. Most patients do not have a rod degeneration. That said, the macula, even though we tend to think of that as being an area of really high cone density, is also an area of really high rod density. And if we ever have access to histological samples from donor patients, maybe we will see that there are indeed rods dying more frequently. But it could also just be a mouse-specific thing. This is something we just have to be mindful of as we continue. When we looked at this unusual mouse model with the all cones, what we were able to learn is that the cones will degenerate, but only in the absence of rods. And now I want you to be patient with me, but this is one idea that this sparks in me and it requires further testing. But perhaps the way to think about translating this to the human is perhaps the fragility of the foveal cones, right? So in the center of the macula, you have the fovea, and the fovea is a foveal is pure cones. Maybe the absence of rods there is what makes that particular population of cells more sensitive, and they degenerate, which then propagates out into the progressive macular dystrophy we see. Then again, could be mouse only, so we need to test that. Because as you saw from those retina pictures, even though this coneful mouse has an all cone retina, it is still not the morphology of a fovea. So we still have to figure out exactly what is making cones so sensitive to degeneration in this disease. With that caveat clearly stated and clearly in mind, I think that as I go forward, if I use both of these models, normal mice and our coneful mice, and I pay attention to these caveats, I think we can still use them and make progress in understanding the basic biology of what's happening. Okay, see, I'm starting to run short on time, so I'm going to speed up, but feel free to interrupt me when you need to stop and ask questions. One thing I'm doing to go forward in the future is I was wondering what else is changing in the retina. One experiment we did is we looked at measuring the various metabolites in the retina. Vast majority of things did not change, but we saw changes in two metabolites. One is NAA or N-acetyl aspartic acid, and the other is in taurine. What these are free amino acids, meaning they look like amino acids, but they don't actually get incorporated into proteins. What they have in common is that they both function as osmolytes. So changing levels of these molecules can reflect water stress or stress due to protein folding. What's strange to me is that in one case, the NAA levels are going up, but in the other case, taurine, the levels are going down. And this is an effect due to genotype and not age. Our young mice are 1.5 months old, and our old mice are a little over a year old in this case. And you see the effect at both ages. So I was going to tell you just a bit more about what we think we know about NAA and taurine. I'm going to go really, really quick through that. We really don't know very much about NAA in the retina per se, but we do know that increased levels are a hallmark of a disease called Canavan disease. Canavan disease is caused by mutation in an enzyme that breaks down NAA, releasing acetate that is used to build lipids in oligodendrocytes. So you have a defect in myelin synthesis. And in terms of the retina, that's obviously going to affect the optic nerve, but we don't know if it has any effect on the other, on the retinal neurons themselves. Taurine is more fun. Sorry. We think we know a lot about taurine. If you look in the literature, it does a whole bunch of things, regulates cell volume, forms bile salts in the digestive system. It's been purported to act as an antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, blah, 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 everything. So criminals will sell it to you and tell you to eat it. This is a very dangerous thing, so beware. However, when you look at the scientific literature, there are some interesting things. Every few years, there's a paper on taurine and retinal health. Taurine depletion causes rapid retinal degeneration. It affects cone fret receptors, ganglion cells, rods. If you mutate the transporter required for bringing taurine into photoreceptors, you get a rapid retinal degeneration. So as I go forward, I want to study more about the biochemistry of the channel, and I'll be telling people more about that in my research talk. And from this talk, I want to say we've learned more about the basic biology of this channel. I think in some patients, gene therapy might be a viable option. The big hurdle there is going to be the very rarity of this disease. Gene therapy is incredibly expensive to develop and deploy. Maybe what we learn in mice about various metabolites will give us an alternate or complementary tool, though, to help patients sooner. So stay tuned for that. And if I have time, I have just one more slide I wanted to show to you guys because I want feedback on this. when you think about the future, we always have to ask, what don't we know? So KCNV2 causes a retinal disease, but KCNV2 is not only expressed in photoreceptors. There's some evidence that at least at lower levels, it's expressed, for instance, in the hippocampus. And this is RNA expression data from the Allen Brain Atlas. And don't know the significance of this, but in a paper from about 10 years ago, it was reported that within a group of pediatric epileptic patients, there were KCNV2 polymorphisms. So we know that from the standpoint of retinal disease, you have to do ERG to accurately diagnose the disease. But if a patient is prone to seizures, you do not want to put them under extensive ERG testing. So we don't know if epileptic patients with mutations in KCNV2 might have vision defects for sure. And conversely, we don't know, do our KCNV2 retinopathy patients, are they prone to perhaps having seizures or other cognitive impairments? I don't know, it's pretty rare, but I'm really curious in feedback on that to determine if it is worth taking the time and effort to look more deeply using our mouse models at what's going on in other parts of the brain. And with that, I will stop and take any questions I have time to answer. I'll just stay on my thank you slide. This is my group and my collaborators and my funding, of course.
A very nice kind of translational talk
of how we can go back and forth between human and mouse disease. I know we have other things that other people have to go to in the next minute or two. Are there any quick questions for anyone here? And if not, I would encourage you at noon, she will be speaking on online again. So there's even more detail and our research people will be adding in. And do you have anything more that you want to say, June, at all? No? Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you for your attention.